So hey everybody, this is Mark Frauenfelder, founder and co-editor of Boing Boing, and I am really excited today about the two people that I am interviewing together. The first is Dennis Muren. He is a amazing visual effects artist. He has been the go-to guy when Steven Spielberg, James Cameron, George Lucas, they need special effects. Dennis is the guy that they go to. You are now a senior visual effects supervisor at Industrial Light and Magic. Is that right?
Yeah, I sort of am that, and I do creative stuff. I'm doing full-time. I'm in a few days a week. I look at the work and stuff like that, but I'm not doing a full show or anything. Except, you know, I come up and help here and there. As I get a little older, I'm working a little less.
Uh-huh. Sounds like a great gig. That's great. And so the second person I'm talking to is Robyn Miller. And Robyn is the co-creator of the Super Smash video game Myst and its follow-up title Riven, which I believe holds some kind of a record for being the best-selling video game for over a decade. Is that right, Robyn?
It's like a long time.
Yeah.
Yes.
a really long time. And so the reason that we got you guys together is because Dennis, in the late 60s, you produced a really cool movie that used a lot of stop motion animation effects called EQUINOX. And we're going to talk about that. But Robyn has recently written and directed and starred in a film called The Immortal Augustus Gladstone, and it uses scenes from EQUINOX. So Dennis, one of the cool things when I was just kind of looking into your history, EQUINOX, and we'll talk a little bit about more, but it got its start from an ad in Forrest Ackerman's fantastic Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine in the 1960s. Is that correct?
Well, you know, that's how we got to know each other. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it was in 61 or 62 or something like that. There was an ad for Dave Allen or something, or Mark McGee or one of those. I forget what the actual story was. There was a very small group in LA at that time in the 60s. This is like the early 60s and mid 60s that loved special effects. And I tell you, that number was 8. It was something like that. We knew each other. We'd meet up maybe at Forey's house, you know, once or twice there. And Doug Beswick had a little organ, a little he did over in North Hollywood and in Burbank that few of us would meet. We got to know each other, but it was not anything that was popular. And we loved effects, but you know, there was no future in it. There was no job ever. And I'd been making a lot of these little short films for years and years. And I said, you know, a feature is just a bunch of shorts, which is the way Ray Harryhausen and other people always looked at it. Let's make a feature. And I had some, and Mark was said, oh, I'll write a script. And Dave said, yeah, I've got some time. And I figured we could shoot it in 2 weeks and do the effects through the summer and then sell it like to a TV station or something. And that's essentially what we did. And Mark wrote the script. And of course, after we finished the script, we thought it was great, but it was really only for a half hour movie. So we were like screwed. And it was like, you know, the middle of summer and we only had a half hour. And school was starting up soon in a few weeks. And that's why it ended up taking 2 years to actually get finished.
So I'm curious about how you learned the technical aspects of the special effects, because they're really sophisticated. I mean, how did you learn how to make ball and socket armatures for the creatures and things like that? There really weren't manuals on how to do that kind of thing. Did you guys like hang out with Ray Harryhausen or what happened?
You know, I think the big in for us really was Jim Danforth. Dave and I worked a little bit at a company called Cascade and got to know Jim. And Cascade had a mill and a lathe and all that sort of stuff. I was never good at making those things. I would make them, but Dave was the guy who really did it, made the creatures in EQUINOX. And, you know, he learned a lot from Jim. And I don't know where they came, you know, where they... real original ideas came from. I don't think there were very many photos of those things even in those days. Hanging out with Ray, we barely met him a couple of times, but somewhere there were probably armatures or something that one of us had or had seen photos of, and it was kind of figuring it out from that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Dave had the Taurus creature Equinox he'd already made, and came up with the idea for this demon, so he made this demon creature for the two stop motions. Then he had that tentacle thing he made a few before, and we put that in it. And he had a skeleton that we put into one shot also, a stop motion skeleton. So anything we could throw into this, we did.
I'm wondering, how did word get out about Equinox, and why do you think it became the cult classic that it's become? It's something that people refer to again and again.
I know, you know, I shouldn't say this, but, you know, Mark and if Dave were still alive, we'd be laughing about this more than anything. It was just kids making a movie. It's all away, and we have no pretense of anything good, really. But I think there's something that people identify with it, and I don't know what it, maybe it's handmade.
Yeah.
I think one of the reasons probably that it resonates so much is that it shows what can be done when people really focus.
Yeah.
You know, when you got a couple of kids, a few kids that just have decided to make something and stick with it.
Right.
And you guys stuck with this vision for 2 years. It sounds weird saying it because in many ways it's such a silly movie, but it's very cool because you were these very young kids and it's sort of precious. It's kind of this precious vision that was followed through with. And that's, you know, there's a lot of effects in the film that I, you know, are kind of unbelievable that such young kids did. Really are.
Can you remember a time that you were faced with a special effects challenge or problem and you were really struggling with a solution and then you came up with something that was completely out of the box?
You're talking about on Equinox?
Or anything that you worked
with? Yeah, I've been a real studier of effects since I was a kid, and I would look at some film and say, that looks really great. I look at another film and says, that doesn't look very good at all. You know, and that's a multi-million-dollar movie. How come that looks fake and this low-budget film looks good? So I was very opinionated on stuff that I liked. And I studied that stuff and learned all sorts of different techniques. And this is like, you know, by the time I was like 15. So when Equinox came and I'd been doing all these little effect sequences, I had a pretty broad idea of how to do low-budget effects and all. So all the way through it, there are solutions in shots that tell the story that may not quite be real, but they do advance the plot for it. And that was, and it was tough. You know, there's so many of them, like at the end of the film when, I think it's maybe at the beginning also, I can't remember. No, it's at the end. When the kids are, there's a big explosion and the guy and the girl stand up and the ground starts shaking and they run away and then she gets killed and he goes running off. How do you do that? How do you get them in the same shot? And I wasn't going to compromise on the shot. I wanted that. So I thought, okay, we'll shoot the people and we'll black out the top and bottom when I shoot them. And I did that. And then we'll shoot a miniature and we'll black the ground out, the bottom of the frame out there. But there's like two separate pieces of film. But I want to shake the camera because it'll look better. So how do you shake the camera without, in those days on film? So I put together a little tiny thing that ended up being like an optical printer. And I could put the two pieces of vector chrome film right next to, you know, on top of each other by packet. And I think I went with white instead of black. That's what it was. So you could see through the white part to the other piece of film and then re-photograph that frame at a time and shook the camera all the time as we did this one frame at a time just to give it that shake. Now you look at it. And you can kind of see the ground and you kind of see a shake and you know it's a split screen in there. But something that I've always wanted was to put those sort of artifacts of reality into effect. So it looks like they were shot at the same time. And I can see it in Equinox. All that time I was thinking about, I want to pan the camera. I want to move in here. I want this to do that. And I still do that. I've always done that, you know, in Jurassic, you know, the Gallimimus is running along with a Steadicam shot. I mean, who'd done that? And there were things in that big, the shot, one of the big amazing ones for me was in Empire Strikes Back. There's a helicopter shot near the beginning where you're moving in. It looks supposed to be on Hoth, I guess it is. And you tilt down in one shot and you see the Tauntaun running along with the guy on it. That's like an impossible shot to do at that time. And George said, well, you know, figure it out. He showed it to me. I said, no, there's no way to do this with that camera moving 6 degrees of freedom and the camera's pushing in and we're dealing with models and optical printing and, you know, it can be reprojected and it should be a big model. No, he said, well, we got this helicopter plate. See, you know, think about it. And within 15 minutes, I'd figured it out. And if I'd stopped at 14 minutes and 59 seconds, I wouldn't have figured it out. And I would have thought, there's no way to do it. And I've worked with people that I've gone to and I've given them a problem. And I've said, okay, what do you think? Have you figured out a way to do it? And I say, there's no way to do it. Well, maybe it's because he didn't think about it enough. Mm-hmm, you know, that's really it.
Yeah.
So I think that's kind of what you're seeing in Equinox is that in some way, at least the fact that it got done and all these different techniques was I was just scrounging with anything I could put in there to tell the story and then trying to give it this sort of like spin of looking not static like all those 50s movies. I talk about like in the 50s movies, but they were shot so poorly. And I really have always liked, I think there's a perfect shot for every scene. Oh, you know, well, you also shot it 1:1, you know? So I just predetermined the camera angle for that amount of dialogue. And that's all we shot. Mm-hmm. And we never had a take two or anything. So the movie is like, you know, I like to say like Hitchcock did it, but a lot of other people would do it too if they had no budget movies is you'd predetermine the angle and shoot it. But boy, that means you can get in with some real dramatic camera angles at specific moments that you want, you know, you want to tell the story. Mm-hmm. So it just cut right together.
Uh-huh.
So you shot the thing with the whole movie with no sound. And right. Then you came back later, you edited it, I guess. After editing, you came back in and you laid the sound in.
Right.
Is this correct?
Yeah. Just like the French.
Dis ce que tu veux. Ça m'est égal. Je vais mettre tout ça dans mon livre.
Quel livre?
J'écris un roman.
Toi?
Pourquoi pas moi? Qu'est-ce que tu fais?
J'enlève ton chandail.
Pas maintenant, Michel.
The reason that new wave thing worked in Europe was they came up with the little Eclair cameras, the 35 and the 16. Mm-hmm. Primarily the 35, quick loading, small, and they shot silent. Mm. And you can just steal a movie if you're shooting silent because nobody knows what you're doing. If you get sound, then everything changes. You've got to keep people away because you can see what's happening. You got to stop the traffic. You got to talk loud enough. You got to have a big boom. That's, you know, but boy, you go silent and you can make anything, you know, and I just figured later on, we figured out some way to add the sound. Let's just get the images because that's what I was concerned about. Anyway, it was the images. And I did find a guy Dale White, who was a sound guy in Pasadena, who invested found some people who invested another $2,000 at the end. And they made what was actually at Magnasync in Burbank at that time. It was a company that made magnetic recording stuff, 16 millimeter mag tape. They put together the first, I believe, sync between a 16 or anything between a projector and the tape recorder. So you could turn one on and the other would copy it exactly. And literally we'd sit in a booth with the actors or whoever, and they'd run it and they would just start talking until they fumbled. But the funny thing is those European films are just as bad.
I mean,
you know, they probably weren't looping either. They probably didn't have the money. So they were doing the same, you know, the same sort of thing. You know, Godard and Truffaut and everything, they were all stuck with the same problems.
So I guess they changed the dialogue quite a bit. Your actors changed the dialogue.
You mean on the Harris version?
On your version from the shooting of it to...
There's a few times in there when you can see that the dialogue was changed, mm-hmm. but most of the time we tried not to, you know, we couldn't, but there are times you see the mouths are doing things a little bit different. Okay. Mostly what you're seeing is it's just out of sync.
So Robyn, I have a question for you. maybe you could articulate a little more about what it is about Equinox that you found so compelling that you wanted to include in the Immortal Augustus Gladstone.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I was searching for footage all over the place, online mostly. And I was looking for footage that might represent the character in some way when he was talking about this subject of not being a servant of Satan. I wanted it to have kind of an amateurish feel. And definitely a nostalgic feel. And so I ran across your footage. I didn't know you had done it. I didn't know what it was from. Mm-hmm. I don't even think it was titled what I had found. And so I just knew it was it when I saw it, mm-hmm. just the kind of the sense of the footage. And so, and it was the footage I found specifically was this demon coming down out of the sky, you know.
You know, one of the things he told me that he had read is that in olden times, vampires were thought to be servants of Satan. That they would go around, and that's why they killed vampires, because they actually believed that they would protect Satan. Now, is that true? Am I a servant of Satan? When I first heard that, when he first told me that, I had to think about that. I had to deal with that because all of this was new all at once. So I had to think, I'm a good person. And that is not me.
I'm curious, what do you think of like the second version as opposed to the version that you did?
Yeah, you know, I thought the second one was more entertaining.
Okay.
Because the first one I would fall asleep, probably not really, but you know, maybe I knew it too, but I thought that it was just too cheap looking. The mm-hmm. second one was sort of sleazy. I didn't like that sleazy side. None of us who worked on it. Mm-hmm. I'm the only one that liked the Harris version a little bit more, but he missed it completely by making it a cheap movie and adding all the Forest Ranger cliches. We were adding cliches, but they were cliches people loved. I don't think anybody loves the cliches that they added, mm-hmm. that Jack added to it, you know. Mm-hmm. But it worked for him, you know, and he got it out. He, you know, played in Hollywood Boulevard, you know, some nice photos around of a big cutout he had on the lobby, or actually on the billboard in front of the theater in Hollywood. So I was very glad that, you know, it had a nice conclusion at least and got out.
Right. He accomplished that, and that's pretty amazing.
Well, he was a professional. You know, he was a distributor. He had the money. He put money into it. We didn't have any resources. Right. Didn't know anything about that business. So he recognized when he saw it that, you know, I can put these creatures on the posters and get people in the theater and let's spend as little as possible to get a movie long enough that they won't be running out of the theater demanding their money back.
Right. For myself, historically speaking, looking back at both films, I like the first one better because this is a bunch of kids that did this film, and it has a more pure quality to it.
Right. That's what people say. Yeah. And I think, and I can sort of see it as an innocence. And if you look at, if you know the films of the 50s, it's very true to those films.
Yeah.
And they were so naive, but they were made by, you know, professional studios, which is pretty weird, or semi-professional studios.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you guys, we're coming up on a half an hour. This has been so much fun, Dennis, getting to hear about the early history of your career. I also think an interesting fact is that you have more Academy Awards than any living person currently.
That's true. Whoa. That's true. Right?
That's amazing. 9 awards. That's great.
It's pretty amazing, and I'm as surprised as anybody about that.
That's cool. Well, it's totally well deserved.
And actually, going from these little an independent film like that to working in major films is another weird thing.
Oh yeah,
how that happened. I was someone who was, of course, never going to get a 9-to-5 job ever. Mm-hmm. I was never going to do that. And then what do I end up doing? Of course, I didn't. I got an 8-to-8 job.
Yeah, exactly.
But if you love it enough, you know, you do it.
Yeah, it ceases to be work, and it's more of just enjoyable problem solving.
Right, right.
Yeah.
It still is.
Yeah, that's great. Well, this has been so much fun. Sure. Thanks so much, Dennis and Robyn. All right. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Oh, thank you. This is great.
Yeah.
And Dennis, it's very nice to meet you.
Well, yeah. Thanks. Nice to meet you too. And I appreciate the interest in Equinox.